everyone, and welcome to the 8th episode of Corporate Law Updates by the Corporate Law Journal. This is Isha BD, and we will be covering some latest updates by SEBI, IBBI, MCA, and RBI in this episode. Let's start this episode by discussing the last week updates by SEBI. SEBI has issued 5 circulars and 3 press releases. The first circular was issued by SEBI on 21st September pertaining to alternate risk management framework for the commodity derivative segments. SEBI, via circulars of 2015 and 2016, had prescribed the risk management framework for CDS due to extreme volatility observed in its prices globally. SEBI constituted a task force of clearing corporations and market participants in order to combat such scenarios where the prices fall nearly to zero or negative. The AMRF shall be applicable to the following: the commodities having the characteristics as susceptible to the possibility, commodities that need specialized storage space in physical markets, and also to the commodities that can't be disposed of with ease. The clearing corporation has been directed to comply with the present circular to implement the AMRF system within 60 days from the date of release of this circular. The second circular was issued by SEBI on the same day relating to writing off of shares held by the foreign portfolio investors. SEBI had issued the operational guidelines for the FPIs and the DDPs back in November 2019, and in the said SEBI FPI regulation, the FPIs who wished to surrender their registration were allowed to write off the shares only in cases of unlisted, delisted, illiquid, and suspended companies. Due to requests received from the shareholders, SEBI has now decided to permit the said FPIs to write off the shares of all the companies where they are unable to sell. The third circular was issued by SEBI on September 23, 2020, pertaining to the trustees of the mutual funds. Recently, on August 20th, SEBI had issued guidelines on resources for trustees of mutual funds, and it was going to come into effect from October 1st, 2020. Due to certain representations received from Association of Mutual Funds in India, SEBI has extended the compliance of the said circular with effect from January 1st, 2021. All other conditions of the above circular shall be applicable as it is. The fourth circular was issued on system-driven disclosures. SEBI, through circulars of 2015 and 2016, introduced system-driven disclosures, and the recent circular of September 9, 2020, provided for a broad framework for the SSD implementation. In order to bring all the circulars on the same page, SEBI has decided to use the procedure of capturing the PAN of the promoters from listed companies as mentioned in circular of 9th September for SEBI acquisition of shares and takeover regulations disclosures too. Rest all the other conditions prescribed by SEBI under the 2015 circular shall be in force as it is. The last circular was issued on September 23, 2020 for issuing the guidelines applicable to investment advisors. After a few consultations and considerations on inputs received from public, SEBI has reviewed the framework of regulation of investment advisors and notified certain amendments which will be applicable since September 31, 2020. Adding to that, the investment advisors shall ensure the compliances of certain conditions mentioned in the present circular in detail, among them client level of segregation and distribution activities, the agreement between the client and the IA, and the fees shall be complied within April 1st, 2021. Further, maintenance of records, risk profiling, and suitability for non-individual clients and display of details on websites shall be complied by January 1st, 2021. The three press releases are as follows, and the first one was issued by SEBI on September 21st, 2020, pertaining to the sanctioned list of names approved by the UN Security Council Committee. The SEBI Master Circular Guidelines on Anti-Money Laundering Standards and Combating the Financing of Terrorism, Obligations of Securities Market Intermediaries under the Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002 and rules framed there under dated October 15, 2019 states that registered intermediaries should ensure that accounts are not opened in the name of anyone whose name appears in updated list of individuals and entities which are subject to various sanction measures such as freezing of assets or accounts, denial of financing services, etc. The second press release was notified for constitution of a technical group on Social Stock Exchange. The working group on Social Stock Exchange submitted its report on June 1, 2020, and the recommendations made was the participation of NPOs and FPEs on SSE subject to minimum requirements, standardization of financial reporting by NPOs on SSE. There was a need to develop the framework for the same, and henceforth SEBI has constituted the technical group chaired by Mr. Harish Banwala along with other 12 members. The last press release was issued by SEBI on September 23, 2020 pertaining to the eligibility and disclosure requirements for rights issues. SEBI, in order to make the fundraising faster, easier and cost effective, amended the SEBI ICDR regulations of 2018 and thereby rationalized the eligibility criteria and disclosure requirements for the rights issues. Moving on to the IBBI updates. The first update is that the IBC Second Amendment Act 2020 got the President's assent. The Amendment Act deals with the Section 66 and 10A of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Section 10A has been inserted by the Amendment Act, which empowers government to notify the period of suspension of initiation of insolvency resolution process for defaults arising on or after 25th March 2020 for 6 months or any other period as notified by government not exceeding 1 year. The second update is regarding the notification issued by Ministry of Corporate Affairs suspending the insolvency proceedings for the next 3 months. Exercising its powers under Section 10A, MCA has suspended the initiation of insolvency proceedings for the defaults occurred on or after 25th March 2020 till 25th September to further period of 3 months. Moving on to the updates from the Reserve Bank of India. On 25th September 2020, the RBI issued a notification in regard to the formation of new districts in the state of Arunachal Pradesh and assignment of lead bank responsibilities. Government of Arunachal Pradesh, through the official gadget on various dates, has specified the effective date of functioning of different districts in the state. The decisions to appoint the lead bank responsibility of these new districts has been given in this notification. Effective date of functioning of the district Lower Siang is yet to be notified by the government. Lead bank responsibility will be assigned for both Lower Siang and Lipada districts separately. The district working codes of the new districts has been allotted for the BSR reporting by banks. There has been no change in the lead bank responsibilities of other districts in Arunachal Pradesh. The second notification is in regard to the positive pay system for check truncation system. Positive pay is a process of reconfirming key details of large value checks. Issuer of the check submits electronically certain minimum details of that check to the drawee bank, details of which are cross-checked with the presented check by CTS. Discrepancy found is flagged by the CTS to the drawee bank, who would then take redressal measures. National Payments Corporation of India has to develop the facility of positive pay in CTS and make it available to participant banks. This system is to be implemented from January 1, 2020. This directive has been issued under Section 10(2), read with Section 18 of Payment and Settlement Systems Act of 2007. Lastly, moving on to the updates from the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, on 24th September 2020, the MCA issued a notification in regard to the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Application to Adjudicating Authority Amendment Rules 2020. In exercise of the powers conferred on the central government by the Section 239, 2C, D, E and F, read with Section 7, 8, 9 and 10 of the IBC 2016, the following rules are further amended. Rule 4, subclause 3 is substituted and now the applicant has to serve a copy of the application to the registered office of the corporate debtor and the board by registered post or speed post or by hand or by electronic means before filing with the adjudicating authority. Rule 6, subclause 2 is substituted and now the applicant under the Rule 6, subclause 1 shall serve a copy of the application in the similar manner as he has to do so under the amended Rule 4, subclause 3. Rule 7, subclause 2 is substituted and now the applicant under Rule 7, subclause 1 shall serve a copy of the application to the board by a registered post or by hand or by electronic means before filing it with the adjudicating authority. Form 1, Form 2, Form 5 and Form 6 are further amended and Form 5A has been inserted. That will be all for today and don't forget to like, comment and share. Also subscribe for the latest updates from the corporate world. Thank you.